I'm going to call the meeting to order. John should be along anytime. I'm sorry we're a couple minutes late. All right, let's get started. I do hope John gets here while we're discussing the tax rate. All right. Any public comment on items not on the agenda?
I have something.
You do?
So I have the contract for the lift. I think I sent to you and Cliff maybe.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So we can talk about that under the town hall or?
Yeah, probably under the town hall update.
Yeah.
Makes sense. Okay, additions or changes to the agenda? I guess that's an addition. All right. Let's talk about the audit, Sandra. How are we doing?
The audit continues to be ongoing. The auditors were last here on the 13th. That was two Fridays ago. Mm-hmm. They were focusing primarily on FY18 at that time. They thought they would have a draft management letter to us within 2 to 3 weeks of that date.
For FY17?
For FY17 as well. They anticipate returning for one additional day, mm-hmm, to finish up with FY18. They don't think they'll need another day beyond that. And that management letter, I would think, would be out within 4 to 5 weeks after that. So most of their work now is being done in their office. They bring reports with them. I generate reports for them that they ask for, and then, mm-hmm, they do their work.
Excellent.
At their desks.
Yeah, that's great. How's the NEMRIC working? You had some. I know you had some glitches.
So NEMRIC is very efficient, and I'm happy to be on it. However, Windows 10 and NEMRIC are not interfacing very well. Fortunately, if there's any critical information that has to be done that I can't afford to lose for whatever reason, I'll hop on one of the other computers that has the Windows 7 operating system.
Are they going to be able to fix that?
I do not know. It may be that they cannot really fix that. So what we're seeing is a shutdown of the program. I don't have two NEMRIC programs up at the same time. That seems to help. And at random times, Windows shuts down NEMRIC. And it has not been with any disastrous effects. I had one instance, which you are aware of, where the effects were disastrous. A lot of sensitive data was lost, several hours worth. We recovered that, we moved on from that, and so I'm just very careful. I don't know if there's a fix. I've talked to other financial people, or one other financial person, and it seems to be an international situation with Windows 10 not really being happy.
So other towns are having the same problem.
Other companies are having the same problem.
Oh my.
So I don't think Windows 7 is, I don't even know that you can purchase that anymore.
Probably not.
No, so it just seems to be the, we'll just work around it. Because it is so efficient, even with that, it is much more efficient as an operating system to use. Things are going pretty good. Hi, John.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like, there seems like there should be a way to have a fix to that, but.
Sometimes it's just programs don't talk to programs.
Yeah, they need to, it's just weird.
Well, I don't want to burn up a lot of tech time. Mm-hmm. They do bill us for anything extra, and I have not received, he runs test after test. He's been on my computer for hours at a time, and there is no apparent problem anywhere to be found.
As
I said, I don't really want to burn up too much more time.
Right.
If it's a problem with Windows 10, which I am now beginning to hear about Windows 10 problems, mm-hmm, across the board, it just might be something we'll have to live with for the moment.
Good.
We'll work around it.
So I see you have the grand list?
So this morning, the grand list, the final grand list was lodged, and that has several results in several things. You have a 2018 grand list. It's a final grand list. Mm-hmm. We have an as-built entity in NMRC grand list, which means we can program the town tax into it. We can accept the state information that mm-hmm. comes to us. That would be homestead declarations and their and the non-residential and homestead tax rates.
And that's grand list total is on this spreadsheet. This is a new spreadsheet that
yes.
you did today, right?
So initially they had run a grand list and then they updated it. There, they really wanted to wait until the last possible minute. The mm-hmm. 25th is their last possible minute by law.
Mm-hmm.
And they were satisfied that they got it as close as they could. And
yeah, I mean, it's a little bit higher. A little bit higher than the grant, than the...
Can you state what the number is?
It is $2,013,117.46.
So the higher...
It's right there.
It's right there, Donna.
The higher your grand list, the lower your taxes, as there's an inverse proportion to that. These are hard copies with all of your backup... So your town tax rate is composed of three elements. The actual town tax rate, which is your which results from dividing the amount to be raised in taxes as was voted at town meeting by the grand list. And that rate is 0.68373. So you kind of tweak and jiggle with that. We only go out 4 decimal points, not 5.
Okay, so 6 tax rate, 68373. Yep.
Right. Would you do me a favor and kind of highlight, go down
oh,
with me?
Oh, Cliff is driving.
Oh, Cliff, could you just go? So if we then go down a couple more clicks. Actually, if we go down to the very bottom after the last highlight. Oops, you were there. Oh, you were there. Okay, that first grand list item.
Okay, now we're at non-residential, so do we want to go back
So you
up?
Want to go down 2 spaces.
Okay.
There you are. Where are we? Here, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to take you back up.
Okay.
Going back up. 6837. All right. So we want to raise this by taxes. This is our grand list. This is one proposed rounded rate. Notice, of course, we're not going out 5 digits.
We can only go out 4, right?
Correct. So what you do is you're going to play with the last digit. That's really all that it boils down to. And this raises $6,800 less than what you agreed to at town meeting.
Okay.
So it raises this amount. Could someone advance further into that? And so here we are with our grand list again, and we jiggied with the last decimal point. Mm-hmm. And that raises $13,400 more than the expenses or the amount of money to be raised mm-hmm. on the grand list. So that is your first component. Those are your 2 options. Mm-hmm. Those are your 2 options, to raise a little less or to raise a little more. So the next piece of this is, there should be one more sheet. Yes, I sent over. Those are recommendations, but is there another sheet over here that is the local agreement rate? Oh, here, try that. Yeah, so let's hop over there.
I didn't see all of them.
So we have another component of our town taxes. It's called the local agreement rate, and in this town, the local agreement rate is composed of types of taxes. One is for the veterans exemption, and the other local agreement rate is for the non-contract values of properties. So I think.
Is that, so those would be things like the.
Community center.
Yeah, okay.
Exactly.
Non-contract, I've never heard that term.
So it's, they're called non-approved, non-residential contract exemptions. So what it means is, by law, the state recognizes certain entities that are not taxed. For instance, school buildings and churches are those examples that we know best. But you as a town, your voters have the right to exempt other properties that are not recognized by the state. And so you do have a list of those properties, and in your handout, they are listed, they're in the grand list.
Yeah, that's
you, you know them, John. You
know. Yeah, I know that. I just never heard that term used.
Yeah,
yet, so.
Yeah, you know.
So, the value of those properties, of those contracted, but see, what the state, we use the word contracted because the state considers the town having a contract with those
an
parcels.
Agreement. Okay.
Agreement.
I see.
It's a weird word, right?
Yeah.
So, that is the value of those parcels. It was the same as last year, by
but
the way.
But different than the school buildings, which are exempted,
which are exempted by statute.
We have to make up the difference in the education tax amount for those buildings, right?
Right.
Because we're assessing, not assessing them.
Right. We agree not to make
the state assessment for this property, the education tax still applies to those, correct?
And that's right. And it's the non-residential tax rate that is applied. Is this correct? Because they're not residential properties, right?
Okay.
That makes sense now. All right, gotcha.
So we reduce that by 0.01, and all the numbers that you basically are looking at are reduced by 0.01. And if you want to see the full number, you would multiply by 100. So we reduce by 0.01 to make the numbers more meaningful and easier to deal with. And so when you see that happen, that is why. And the grand list itself that's printed off of NMRIC, but comes from the state with the calculations that the listers put in, also reduces the grand list by 0.01 to make it easier to use. So the non-residential educational tax rate this year is 1.6039, and so the amount of monies these parcels would have contributed to the non-residential tax collection, it says rate, but what they really mean is this is what they would have paid, is this $94.34.14. So we need to go and make sure we collect that from our townspeople so we can pay that to the state.
Okay.
This is the same idea as our town taxes. We divide what we need to collect by the grand list. And again, we have a 5-digit proposed tax rate. So we're going to play with that number. The next few calculations will look at that number and round it up or down. So here is this 0.0047. And we want to hop down just a titch.
It's being cantankerous.
It must be Windows 10.
It is.
So we're gonna use 0.0047, and this is what 0.7 would raise, that 94.61.65. I expanded that number so you know in thousands what we're talking about, because it's not, you know, $27.51. It's really $2,759 more than we need, right? We need that amount. But we would be raising $27.51 more. So I rounded it down to see what would happen, and to 0.0046, and then we collect $17,380 less. So between the two, you'll decide which rate you want. I have a recommendation for you, but let's go on and take a look at the veterans exception, because that's the second piece of your local tax rate, and it's just the second sheet. You could scroll right down.
Okay, if you would let me. Anyway.
If you had a Mac, you'd be right there, you know.
I do have a Mac. It's a nice truck.
So the number of Calis veterans are seven. And the state, pardon me, and the voters of Calais voted the full exemption allowed by law, which is $40,000. However, the state only recognizes $10,000 per veteran. So once again, this is similar to contract in that we are allowing for more than the state allows, so we must go to our taxpayers and generate the amount of money that would have been collected from our veterans.
The difference.
If we did not, if we only allowed 10,000 and not 40 mm-hmm. per veteran. So that amount of money, simple arithmetic, is $210,000. So again, we reduce that by one, and what we need to collect is $2,100. And once again, we divide that $2,100 by our grand list value, and our five-digit tax rate is 0.00104. So then I played with that a little bit. And we could go down. And there we are. So at 0.0011, it raises, that particular tax rate raises $11,443 more than we need. I rounded it down. And that 0.0010 rounded raises 86.88 less than what is needed. So that one little decimal point makes a big difference. And the reason it does is, again, because we have collapsed these numbers by multiplying the number by 0.01. So let's go to recommended, please. And so it's tricky, right? Mm-hmm. So what I'm recommending is this, that, and this is for your decision naturally, is that you, if your town tax rate is 0.6838, you're raising 13,400 more than needed. Your non-residential contract rate raises 2751 more than needed. Your veterans exemption rate, that one, raises 8688 less than needed. So your overall tax effort is over by roughly $7,400.
You mean that we're collecting?
Yes, out of $1,300,000+.
We're collecting more, a little bit more, $7,400.
This recommendation would, and this is a real number, this is not an expanded number, by the way.
And that's, Sandra, I'm assuming you did various permutations, and that is, if you combine the overs and unders in various ways, this combination produces the lowest over.
There is one other combination that produces literally $59 over, or is it $39 less over. But okay. your numbers you would be selecting a number. You would be selecting a proposed rounded rate that raises $17,300 less than what you need, and I think that's less defensible.
Right.
So again.
So this is the one that produces the lowest over.
No,
because there's another.
There could be another. There's the other combination that produces
$39 over.
This amount less $39.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
So, you would just add them all up, but it's the rate that raises $17,380 less than you need, and that just feels, I have a hard time picking a rate that raises so much less.
We've been advised not to set a tax rate that is less than what we need.
Mm-hmm. So, Donna had a question.
Yeah, I just want to, Jim Barlow told us we can't raise more than what we need. So the non-res and the vets is what it is. So it's really what you're fiddling around with is the actual town tax rate. Right?
Well, we're actually fiddling around with all three because we had six rates that we looked at.
Well, when you set like the vet one, you know, you get as close as you can, you reduce all those decimals at the end. But it's really the town tax rate that then you're trying to get as close as possible to what you need to raise.
That's right. And this is as close as we can possibly get, given the variable permutation of the last digits.
I mean, Jim Barlow said we should never not raise enough taxes. You're not supposed to raise more than.
Well, you don't want to raise more than, and that's absolutely
so,
right.
I don't know how you, if you can't.
You can't go out five digits. You can only go out four.
Not, and that's a state requirement?
Yes, that's the way the program works. And that is the way your tax rates work in the state mm-hmm. of Vermont. So you do have choices.
You can save that aside and refund it.
You have income that is not going to come in. Your state aid to highway is down by a titch. Current use is going to change a little bit. You have eight current use properties that Jen tells me that may change a little bit. Your budget, so, you may go over budget. It's really your call.
So I don't know what you mean by those dollars aren't in. You mean they're not going to be counted? They're not going to be the same amount that we
your
thought
projections.
They were going to be?
Well, they are always projections.
Right,
and
right,
you're projecting
that.
18 months ahead, so you make your very best
right.
guess. And the state aid to highway is not off by much, maybe $1,000. But if you have three or four things of projected income off by $3,000 or $4,000,
but the eight properties that you're talking about,
they. Jack feels that they are going to affect the very minimally.
But why are they not?
Because the state is behind.
Okay, I know they were like 50,000 or something. I remember seeing the email about how far behind they were, and so they're still, they haven't gotten it completely done?
Current use properties are not entirely through the state yet either.
So this number actually, when all is said and done, is actually, we still may be short. I mean, that is one possible outcome. So this is a projection as well. It's a best guess.
It's a best guess. So you can also figure this another way and only be $100 over.
Right.
So you can do this. Though, if you would.
Donna had another question.
So we budgeted for current use $95,000 because that's what we had last year. But now the state's told us that we have $101,864. Even that's a guess. So it's, what, $6,000 more. But why wouldn't that be changed in the budget?
I have a legal opinion on that. You have set your proposed income in your article, and I may not change that.
And what about the...
That is your attorney. You saw that email.
The town hall payment, is that going to be the same, do you know?
It is very close. I think it's a little more. I think it's closer to 49.
You mean that's the loan?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you were saying
we pop into this, if you go onto the first sheet,
expenses.
It's called expenses, it is what it's called. We can, would you do me a favor, Cliff, and copy that grand list number here to that cell, into this cell.
This cell?
You're working, yes, please.
Okay, didn't like that. Let's try.
Or did this type it in?
Yeah, I think that's going to be the best way.
Oh, down below more.
Below 69.
Below.
All right, and then in this cell, let's scroll up here. I have it. Don't scroll up. Stay right there. And then in this cell, let's put 0.6895. 0.6895.
Where did you get that one?
And that is from your second page of your package. It's a combination of the proposed, these are just exercises for you to consider. These are a combination of the three recommended rates, so you can see how that works. So we want to multiply, this cell here should be sum of
zero.
The grand list multiplied by the total tax rate. That's 0.6838 plus 0.0010 plus 0.0047, the recommended rates. That's what we're working with right at the moment. So So this is what we, this is what this combined rate will raise, 1,388.44. And what we need to raise is pop over here.
1,3.
We need to raise 1,376.436. And then put this one in there, put this one above it.
Okay.
Sorry. Whoops. Right above it, because we're going to do a, we're going to subtract.
1,388.044.
No, subtract.
And now this is going, we're going to subtract this from that.
To show us how much extra we would be raising.
Yeah. 11,608. Now, go back to our local agreement rates. And what we need to raise, it just use this cell here, and this cell will do $2,100. And underneath, $9,434.14. $9,434.14. We're going to add them together down here.
Get out of there. These two.
They're not cooperating.
H61.
It must be hard. Is he on his screen, or does he have to look up here to
both.
See what he's doing?
Both.
Okay. Whoops. So these two together, give it what we actually need to raise is $11,534.14, and we're going to raise $11,680. That's the overage. So some tweaks happen, and this is your double check. It is just simply my recommendation that these numbers work. And again, you can pop over to that first sheet where you can see what the combined tax rate times the grand list produces minus what we're supposed to raise.
Yeah.
And that is the overage.
But it's not so, the overage according to that sheet we were just on.
No, but we have to raise that in addition. So the local agreement rate, if you think about your tax bills, has two tax rates. It has your town tax rate, and it has your local agreement rate. And your local agreement rate is reflected by one number. It's the combination of those two. So a combination of those two rates is supposed to raise $11,500 and some odd dollars, right? So we know that
pays for those other amounts that were on
yes,
the sheet.
Yes, okay, exactly. Gotcha. So we know we need to raise that, but we're stuck in this four-digit world when really a five-digit world gets it exactly.
Right.
Would hit it on the head, but we can't live there because that's how it is. Mm-hmm. So a double check is to take that entire tax rate town and local, multiply it by your grand list, you get the total amount raised by those rates. The difference between what we have to raise by virtue of what was voted on at town meeting and what we actually do raise is this extra $11,608. So as you are reflecting, that's the extra local agreement.
Right,
that's what we have
right,
to
yeah.
get, which is really $116,080 is what it amounts to.
You mean 106, right?
116. We move it over to decimal places.
Oh, okay.
Oh, maybe it's not a million. It's 116. So this is what I have found when I ran the numbers. You have a live spreadsheet. And
so let's look at your recommended page.
So the recommended page recommends those three, which, and that is a combined rate. It's on page 2 of your packet. And that is the combined rate of 0.6895. But
show me on here where this is.
Well, that's your first page.
Where?
And there's your combined rate, 6838.0010
and 0.0047.
So
right here.
There it is.
Okay, gotcha.
So when I went about doing this, I proved it in a few ways. I looked at what we're actually going to raise, mm-hmm. but then the numbers kind of act in strange ways, so you want to do it a couple of ways. And what I found is that we're really very close to on target.
And that's what gets us this $39 or $54 total overage.
Well, I proved it in a couple of different ways. I looked at this, at this set of numbers, and you can select your other tax rates, but you just want to be sure in the end that you proof it. So what is collected in the end is very close. As close as you can possibly be in a four-digit world, four-digit after the decimal point world.
If we look at the rate from last year, I don't have a calculator with me. What's the difference?
Well, that is also on your sheet. So this is last year's rate.
Okay, I see that, but what's the this minus this?
Well, those. We can do it arithmetically.
I did something earlier, and I think you've been in the spreadsheet since then, but I came up with $8.80 per 100,000 difference.
$8.80. It's really quite small from a town.
Yeah, tax does that sound about right to you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you would just subtract here.
Yeah.
Oh, God, this is one of those things that goes by light, so. What is it, 0.6895 minus
0.6844. Yeah.
And it's 0.0051.
0.0051. Okay. And this is the tax, the school tax, right? We don't have any.
No.
Say so over. No. So. All right.
So what you don't have say-so over is what the voters voted in Article 4, and that is your expenses and your total income, both reflected in Article 4. So we are combined by those parameters and also by four digits beyond the decimal point when we're putting this tax rate together.
Mm-hmm.
So this is what I found, and you can work these spreadsheets as you like. And
so this is your recommendation, yes. Is 6895.
Correct. Oh, geez, I didn't add them up, but that is the recommendation. You would recommend these separately.
You mean the veterans?
The town tax, veterans, and the non-residential contract exemptions. And that would be on your page two. And then
right. And we would do it for both non-residential and residential.
Oh, no. The town tax is only one rate. And
just period. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So, board members, questions, thoughts?
I appreciate the walkthrough. Last year we had only one number, unless I'm just not remembering.
Actually, last year you were probably given all of this, but you just didn't read it. I always sent it to the select board.
Okay, so I don't remember spending this time on the breakdown, which is good. I just went straight, when I got the packet today, I went straight to the
bottom line. That's what I looked at.
Yeah, and
last
now.
Last year.
So it's 0.6895 compared to what was the bottom line last year?
0.6844. And that's when I just asked Sandra how much of a difference is it from last year to this year, and it's 0.0051,
right.
And you figured that out to be $8.80.
Yeah, I can't find that.
So
in my
per 100,000,
right,
one way of looking at this, if you wanted to figure out what the difference is per 100,000 of assessed value. This year, per 100,000 of assessed value, you'd pay $689.50. And last year, you paid $684.40. So per 100,000, that's the increase.
Well, say it again.
Sure.
$689.
It's $689.50 mm-hmm. minus $684.40. That is your
tax rate multiplied by 0.01.
So I was looking at some part right when I came up with $8. That's even less.
Yeah, so it's even less.
Like $5.
Yeah, $5.10 per 100,000.
Right.
Which
I think that's
I think that's a really good
that's an important important bottom line.
So I think we did a really good job budgeting, trying not to have much of an increase in taxes. I think we did it.
Yeah, and I think it's important in light of, you know, we've had some deficits in recent years.
Right.
You know, I mean, I'm totally comfortable with this. You know, I think you did a fine job.
Yeah, thank you.
Mm-hmm. I apologize for the lateness of this information. I sweated this, but fortunately I had the basics last week. Yeah. And was able to...
Well, and it was a glitch on the state end, let's say it, like call it like it is.
So, you know, our listeners work really hard to get as much information to you as possible, because what happens then, any changes after this, they go through an errors and omissions process, which you're familiar with. That does change the grand list, but that does not change the tax rate once we set it. It's immutable, and we just live with what we've got.
So, select board members, are you comfortable with the rate as recommended? Any more comments?
I'd like to thank Sandra for the walkthrough as well, and the time that you put into it. This being my first go around with it all in this venue, really appreciate the extra explanation. I guess the question I would have would actually be for Donna. Looking at this and how it's put together, how does it compare to what we've done in the past?
She's using my spreadsheet.
Okay. Yeah, she's using this Donna created spreadsheet.
If somebody wants to compare apples to apples,
Same line by line, they can do that.
And this is the spreadsheet that I always liked. I had the old grand list, but I actually figured out like how my tax rate, what my taxes mm-hmm. would be.
Right.
Okay.
This spreadsheet that Donna originally created is really, really helpful. It really helps you to be able to lay it out. You know, if somebody asks you a question, you can go back and refer to this. So, all right. So I guess I will make a motion to set the 2018 town tax rate at the town tax rounded to 0.638.
No. 0.6838.
I'm sorry, you're right. 0.6838. The veterans exemption voted by the town, the rate would be 0.0010. The non-tax properties are the contracted properties at 0.0047 for a total town tax rate of 0.6895.
Second.
Is there any further discussion or comments? All right, nice job, Sandra.
Thank you.
Discussion is all that matters. All right.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none. Motion carries. Thank you.
I have one more piece of business. I have been, you're aware of this, we have been imposing on our volunteers to make expenditures on behalf of the town and then wait to be reimbursed. The town has not had a credit card, and in the past towns seem to not be able to get credit cards. So I did, there were a couple of
recent
reimbursements that required credit cards, and our volunteers were gracious enough to use theirs. I did inquire of the bank today if it was possible if the town could have a credit card so that we do not have to impose upon our volunteers. I must say, Katie had to put $100 out. Denise has put out many hundreds of dollars in my short tenure here, many hundreds on her own credit card.
Get the receipts.
So they say we can have a credit card
and they will issue it on behalf of the town and our volunteers. If the select board is interested in going further with it, I don't have all the information, so we're not asking for a motion tonight. But I will talk to our bank in the next couple of days to figure it out.
And that would help us when we need to do something, you know, we want to order something online, so people don't have to use their own credit card, all that stuff. I think it makes perfect sense. And then there's also, when we have a credit card, you have the statements, say what it was, and then...
There are the preliminary conversation with Shelley Quinn, our banker, is that there are no fees involved, and there certainly wouldn't be any interest involved, because we would pay it just the same way we pay Staples. As soon as we get the bill, we would pay that bill, or they would arrange to sweep it right out of our account. I don't know the details yet.
So this credit card would be able to be utilized by anyone who we delegate responsibility to. So I would hope that there's a master, maybe the treasurer, in charge of that credit card, and anyone who wants to use it would sign it out. So we know they have it.
Well, I don't think we'd sign it out. I think they would tell me who to call, and I'd give them the credit card.
Oh, you would hand, you maintain control of it. Okay, you wouldn't pass it on.
I mean, first of all, that is your decision, how you want to manage that. We don't know all, I don't have all of the information. I bet our bank has some ideas. Her initial response was because I asked about a debit card. And her initial response is, yes, but debit cards come right out of your account. There's no warrant process. That does not seem to be
the credit card
the
makes
best
more
way
sense,
to go.
Especially if we don't have any fees. And that was sort of my question, the same one as John's, is who gets these credit cards? And we just have one that basically we call Sandra and say we need to order blah, 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 and you do it kind of thing.
Yeah, I'll give you a case in point, which really kind of triggered this further inquiry. Katie came in, her computer, her Windows had expired, and it's not forever anymore, so you have to pay a renewal fee. Mm-hmm. And she offered to put it on her credit card. It was $100. So, you know, that just rankles me. I appreciate it, thank you very much, and I know the select board appreciates it too. That and Denise's willingness, and as I said, the short time that I've been here, it's been hundreds of dollars. It turns out that we can have one if you like the conditions under which it would be granted, and you can agree to how you would use it.
Right.
I'll get back to you on that.
Right, and there's probably some kind of something we can put in the purchasing policy or credit card policy or something like that, to follow up, that I think makes sense. And I think it makes sense. Everybody agree?
I agree. I do think, though, that we will want to have a clear
guideline
policy that, I like the idea that Sandra's the one who uses it. It doesn't just get handed around.
Right. And then, of course, the
We had that porta potty thing that came
right,
up that
and,
was just
and Donna had to, didn't Donna have to, do $480?
We put computers on our credit cards all the time for the town. It's also harder to get the tax, the sales tax. There. If you're using your own personal credit card, they don't want to. They want to charge you the sales tax.
Right.
So there's a few extra steps involved. I think it's just kinder. We have great volunteers in this town. I am always overwhelmed with their service, and I think that going into their own credit cards is, if we can have one, and if it makes sense, that would be a good thing.
Okay.
So I'll let you know.
Good. I think it makes sense. I mean, I haven't minded using mine, but if I didn't have to, that'd be fine too.
That would be fine. It would be better, really.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else, Madam Treasurer or Delinquent Tax Collector Lady?
I think we're down under $12,000 in delinquent taxes.
That's great.
Isn't that great?
That's great.
So we're rolling into FY19 in really great shape. And, I can't take all the credit for that. Nadine left it in good shape. And I must say, I followed in her good stead. I did change a couple of things. But nevertheless, we have enjoyed some we enjoy a very low delinquency at this point in time.
Great.
So it's very good.
So
for
when
us.
Will the tax bills? We've just set the tax rate. When will the tax bills go out?
The good question. The state has asked all towns, or has recommended to all towns who have not already printed their tax bills, to delay until July 27th, and that is a Friday. This Friday. I will program our grand list with our tax information tomorrow with NMRIC on a different computer, on one of the other Windows 7 computers.
Good idea.
But I will not print the tax bills until after the final, or the until after the HS 122 declarations have been
so
downloaded.
So you might not print them until Monday, say.
I might not print them until Monday.
Because you might want to have a little breather, just in case there's a glitch at the state level again.
Well, you know what? That's exactly right. They, right. I don't know when on the 27th they will download. So,
so if they go out on Monday, what's Monday is the
30th.
30th.
They would be due on or about August 1st, as long as that is a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday.
Well, they wouldn't be due August 1st.
September 1st, pardon me.
September 1st is a Saturday, Labor Day weekend.
So they would be due so first, second, third, September 4th, which is your date last year, just so happens.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
We will not need to take a note in anticipation of taxes. We're, you know, we're lucky in that way. This year we'll be fine. We'll be able to get to that point without any problem. And for those of you who heard about a memo and don't know about that, Denise and I are talking about a memo that I received from the state that said they were behind by 14,000 homestead declarations that should have been downloaded into the towns on July 1, but they're behind. And
right.
they anticipate, was
right.
the word they used, to have them down, to be able to download them to the towns on July 27.
All I can say is I'm glad I don't work for the tax.
So they were, what they said is, I mean, in view of the Hawkins situation, that there were 55,000 tax returns this year that required individual
handling,
that there were, and it was, they were complete, they weren't completed entirely, the income information was missing, there was, the names were wrong, the SPAN numbers were wrong, whatever.
Right.
So, you know, they want us to know they're working really hard and they hope to have that information.
We can sympathize.
Yeah.
So
that's where we are, and that's on or about when the tax bills will be due.
Okay. All right. Excellent. Thank you very much.
Thank
anything
you.
Anything else before we move on?
I don't have anything else. Oh, one,
and I got to tell you, Sandra has been working a lot of Fridays, so I've encouraged her to, at some point, take an extra day off, like a Monday or a Tuesday together, and I think that's earned, well earned. If you guys are in agreement.
But thank you. I'm going to take my kid to get her braces off tomorrow morning. How about that?
That
is a better day. 3 years.
That's not what I meant.
I know.
Those are good days. Congratulations.
Right.
It is a great day. The town hall loan proceeds, by the way, were in. I gave you misinformation. My computer wasn't refreshing the day or the days that I was looking at our statement. They were in July 3rd. So our $200,000 for the town hall loan proceeds are sitting in our account. So that loop has been tied.
Okay, so the money's there.
Yes, it is.
Okay.
I believe I told you erroneously that it was not.
Well, it's been, yeah,
but,
you said
but
you were going to look.
It was,
okay.
Yes.
Good, great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome to stay, but you don't have to.
I have to go cook dinner.
Oh, no, let somebody else cook.
I have hungry kids.
No, my husband knows. It's like board meeting night.
Make sure you bring beer home for Buzz. I think he needs one today.
Oh, John, you have no idea.
Well, you do have
I do.
Alfred. So what's going on with the truck, the motor, all that stuff that we've been talking about for how many meetings? Like the last 3 months?
Long. So I talked to them today.
Did you finally get a hold of that person that wouldn't get back to you?
Yeah, well, no. I've stepped down the ladder a little bit, and it seems like getting a lot further.
Oh, okay.
I've talked to the parts manager and the service manager. So we've found a motor a new motor, which is not the option that we chose, I realize. But it seems like a better option over the whole scheme of things.
A new motor to go in to replace the motor that...
The bad motor, right.
Right, okay.
So...
Who has that?
J&B.
And I thought they told you they didn't.
They told me it was going to be difficult to get the motor.
But you persisted.
But through talking to the parks manager, he's found it. And if I order it tomorrow, it'll be here Wednesday.
So is this a factory rebuilt or brand new?
It's a brand new motor, crate motor. Okay. They call it crate motors, brand new.
Okay.
So...
30,000.
There we go. So the original quote that he gave us was 29, well, the way back was 32,000. Mm-hmm. And then I beat him down to 29,297. Now he's given us a $5,000 discount.
So it's 24?
So it's 24,297. And that's complete. I'm making him give
that's
me
install?
A, that's a truck going down the road with a brand new motor in it.
Okay. But it's the same motor that blew just the same.
It is. It's an identical motor. It's the only motor you can put in that truck.
Right, right. I remember having that.
I tried to put a different type of motor, different brand.
But you can't do it.
You can't do it.
Right.
So we're looking at 24,297 with a brand new motor in that truck. And they're telling me that they can. I would have it back by the end of next week.
Do it.
If I order it tomorrow.
Mm-hmm. Do it.
So, and then what? And then we would trade that, though.
Well, that's still the jury's still out on that a little bit. They told me today that that truck with a brand new motor in it would be worth $45,000.
So trade in would be $45,000.
With the new motor in it, which is a good deal more than what we was hearing before.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Which also I will use as leverage against Charlie Boys, because we already hold the slot for the new truck.
Right, and that would be trade-in value towards the lease.
If we go that route.
Right.
We're also exploring the possibilities of selling it outright. We still have that because it's still our truck.
Right.
We're paying to put in the motor in it. We can do whatever we want to with it.
Mm-hmm.
We can sell it to a wholesaler, or we can sell it privately.
Right.
Or we can trade it in towards the new truck. So I think putting this motor in there does a lot for us. First of all, it gives us our trade value back.
Right.
Second of all, it gives us a truck that we can run from now until
the new one
comes, which is looking like January, maybe even February at this point.
Yeah. I think we don't have many other choices.
I mean, it's a hit. We're taking a hit here. There's no getting around it.
Right.
But I think it's the best that we can do.
No, I mean, I think you've really...
I mean, I've got a price from...
You've done a good job getting this...
From Clark's Truck Center, and they were almost $40,000 for the same repair.
Right.
It's a brand new motor.
Right, and we're looking at 22,297 installed, and the truck is ready to go.
In a week.
2 weeks.
Let's call it 2 weeks. Because by the time I'm going to order it tomorrow, it should be there Wednesday. And he said he would jump right onto it. This service manager seems to be lots more willing to help.
Yeah, good.
So I say we get this thing done and...
No, go ahead.
And then we get it, you know, we get it back in service, first of all. And second of all, we can still have a trade.
Right. No, I think everybody's in agreement. Go forward.
Okay.
Yeah.
As far as putting it back in service, would you use it in regular rotation, or would it be your third story?
I would set it in the back burner as much as I could.
Mm-hmm. Just because of our previous experience.
But our also, with that said, our spare truck is getting tired also. So
does this come with any warranty?
I believe the motor would have a 1 year warranty.
Because that would be important to make sure. So in case this motor blows like the other one did, you know, obviously we want to try to get rid of it. within, before a year goes by, but it would be good to know if it has a warranty in case this one blows.
Right.
So we're not back to doing this again.
Well, and is there a market? You said that the issues of the motor are well known, so
yes.
You still think we're going to be able to...
Well, I think we're going to get...
Worst case, we just trade it.
We're going to get $40,000 or $50,000 out of it.
Yeah, $45,000 to trade.
Yeah.
Might be almost better to trade it, and then you're done with it.
Right. Right, because if you sell it to somebody, then they have problems.
Right, and you're going to feel bad. And it's right.
Just, it turns into a sticky situation. And
then who knows how much we might get if we try to sell it outright. I would go with the trade, if it was me.
Right, or even how long it takes to sell.
Right.
I mean, we've had that problem before with trying to sell trucks or used equipment, and it just takes a long time to get the word out. So.
All right, nice. Yay.
So that's done. Okay. I've got a quote. Just drove today for the equipment on the new truck. So there's no surprise. It's the same outfit that we did on the last truck.
You mean on the one that they're putting the motor in already has the equipment, right?
Yeah, that's all.
The new one.
It's the new truck. The new truck that's going to be.
The one from Charlie Boys, maybe.
Yes, okay. And that's like almost 72,000.
That's for like the plow and all that.
The plow, the body, all the hydraulics, all the whole outfit. So I am very much relieved to be done with that one.
Yeah, I mean, I give you a huge amount of credit, Alfred, for sticking with it,
doing
negotiating. I think you did a really good job. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Great.
Okay.
Anything else? I had a couple things.
I can just say we can talk about the Jack Hill culvert a little bit. The culvert didn't get ordered. It did on my part, but the person that we sent it to no longer works for the company. So in their words, it's set in a dark hole somewhere. The contract that we had signed, so it didn't get ordered right away. What happens is that we wait until August 13th before the call gets. So we're only 3 weeks.
Is Toby going to post something else on Front Porch Forum about that? I mean, he posted
the delay, that it's going to be delayed because the culvert didn't come.
Okay, so we're all set.
That is out there. The contractor was fine. He'd already mobilized. He had an excavator on site and was all ready to go. And that morning I got word that the culvert's not coming. So I had to go and tell him, hey guys, take the rest of the day off because there's no culvert to put together.
Right, so they weren't too unhappy about taking the day off.
They were a little disappointed, but they did say that we're not going to charge you. They could have charged us for mobilization.
Yeah, but it's not our fault.
No, but they still
could have, because
now they got to mobilize to another job. And,
right.
But they were nice enough not to charge us for that, and that's
a lot. Who's the contractor?
Griffin and Griffin.
No, Gravel Construction.
Gravel.
Yeah.
Well, that's good. That makes the relationship
a
good one.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I still think that we can get in under the wire as far as the school buses starting up again. It's going to be close.
Yeah, it is going to be close. Do they, because I don't remember this. They start before Labor Day or after Labor Day?
I think
I
can't remember.
It was before, right?
It's usually August. Like you have, like, they go to school for 2 days and then they have 4 days off or some stupid thing.
But even if it's a couple of days, you know, they'll have to just go around for a couple days or something.
Well, I mean, it's something beyond our control, so we want to make sure if we, you know, people understand that it's not anything on our end.
Yeah, and I'll communicate with the bus company about that. That's not a problem.
All right. I had just wanted to put on the agenda the Sandy Luce from the East Callis Church called me, and their volunteers are tired. So they've got somebody lined up to finish painting the backside of the church, and I looked at the ROW that we had issued, and we stated in there it was going to be from this date to this date that they were going to have the road closed. This time they don't even need to close the road. So I just wanted to let you guys know, I don't think there's really a whole lot we can do as far as permit wise except for extend the date, and I think if we can put it in the minutes, and I'll have to get Katie the permit number. But it doesn't amount to any closing of the road. You said you would provide again the barricade things. And it's only going to be like a couple of days that this guy's going to take, and it'll be done in I think he's on schedule to do it in like a couple of weeks from now. So does anybody have any issue with
that? It's perfectly fine.
I mean, I was just going to do it, but I thought, well, we have time. Now, initially, they were going to do it like over last weekend. Mm-hmm. And I had said, well, just go ahead and I'll talk to the board about it. But, oh, here's the permit number, ROW01-2018. So we'll just extend the deadline, mm-hmm. and yeah. I can attach a copy of the minutes to it.
Yeah. My biggest thing is safety, traffic going through right. while there's a guy on a ladder, and I'll be driving by there often enough so I can check out the scene and make sure that it's safe.
Okay, perfect. Okay, last thing on my list. Reappointing the road commissioner.
Oh, here I am in the hot seat.
Do you think we should?
I don't know.
I don't know about this guy. Is he a good negotiator?
Is he reliable? Does he come up with ideas?
Innovations? Yeah.
Ideas outside the box. Yeah. Speaking of boxes.
Oh, that flower really, box idea.
That was really good. That was
a home run.
We were down at North Callis Bridge and you know, the whole thing with the wooden guardrail thing
versus the rest,
and we were kind of trying to like, what can we do? We can't really afford to put in at the cost of $15,000 wooden guardrails. We could put a fascia on the front of it, and then Alfred came up with, well, how about if the town builds you some wooden flower boxes and attaches them to the guardrails, and Alfred's even going to help them plant and.
No.
He's going to build.
Weed. You offer to weed.
Right.
Yeah, right.
No. The other bridge has boxes, right? Don't they have flower boxes on there?
I don't know.
I think they do.
But it was a really good suggestion. It satisfied everybody there except
like
for one person.
Turned right around. After
right.
That.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. No, I mean, so it was a really great idea. So, I mean, I have to say, you're doing a good job.
And most people were struggling with the $15,000. Not everybody, but the $15,000
right. was a lot.
Price tag is really it's a game changer.
Well, and so anyways.
Just for aesthetics.
Right. And I thought they looked fine. I thought those guardrails looked fine myself, but I don't live right there. And we did sort of say we would do those. We're never doing that again.
Yeah, we just...
Right.
Promises.
Right. It was well-intentioned, but anyway, so back to that. So I would like to make a motion to reappoint Alfred as the road commissioner.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Thank you.
Yeah. You shone through once again.
We try.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So who's going to build the window boxes? You or?
We'll do it as a team at the shop.
Yeah. Good team building exercise.
Yeah.
Now, what about the issue of them being made out of pressure treated? You're going
to
make them out of something
we'll
else?
Yeah, we'll have to use hemlock. Hemlock is probably a better wood.
Yeah.
Okay.
For that.
And you're going to have rain days this week, I think.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much.
Yes.
So I have one question before you go on the town hall.
Okay.
So have you stopped over and talked to those guys at all?
I almost did today, but I was.
Oh, okay.
Deconstruction works people are there?
Yeah, this was their first day.
Okay.
You know, and they're going to loosen up the back for Alfred to tear down.
Yeah.
Which they haven't done yet, but they know they're going to do that.
Mm-hmm. The empty 30-yard box is going to show up on Wednesday morning.
You mean the container?
Yeah. So I told them to start cutting the thing off so that any time Wednesday afternoon on,
what do you mean?
I thought, is Alfred going to take stuff to the dump?
No, on Wednesday, Cassell's going to come and switch out those two that are there, bring us a 30-yard one.
Okay, because I know Alfred talked about taking some stuff and putting, just have them dump it in the back of the
town. That's
an emergency situation.
Okay, so we're not doing that at all. Okay, that's good to know.
Not right now.
Okay.
Right. I mean, if we're there and the box gets full,
and
we've got one load of stuff, it's going on one of our trucks.
Right, exactly.
You know, so we can clean it up and get it done.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Good enough.
So that'll work. Yeah. I might steal my excavator before then, just because I got a couple jobs waiting for me, and tomorrow's weather doesn't look too bad.
Yeah.
So, but as soon as I get that cut, I can, you know, I can come back and somebody should be there taking pictures of that or video of that.
Steve Mills is calling us.
Oh, is he?
Give the time to our excavator.
I guess one of us has to call him back, but that might be good when that comes down, because that might be dramatic.
It might be.
Yeah, I don't want to see that.
Land on top of the escalator.
So will that coming down
happen this week? About that.
Pulling it off?
I really doubt it, because the dumpster's not going to be there until Wednesday afternoon, and then I've only got one more day of the week, so. I'm guessing it'll probably be the first of next week.
Okay.
Yeah, I think Deconstruction Works told Scott it would take them 2 days. Do you remember?
2 days to do what?
To deconstruct the interior.
Well, today was a full day, and they still got a lot of
work. Yeah, so I don't know.
Take them longer than they think.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Well.
Okay.
It looks pretty cool in there.
I will stop by and
just
check
be on standby.
Standby. Right. Right. Yeah.
Okay.
So. While we're transitioning, in case we're still on this topic, I have to leave at 8:30.
Right, it's 5 after 8.
Yeah, so I may leave in the middle. I'm picking a friend is sending her 11-year-old to spend a month in Vermont. I have to pick her up at the airport.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That must be hard for the mom to do.
It's, they live in Japan, and she's from New England.
Oh,
so
wow.
He's born and raised, so she's...
So this is good for him.
It'll be really good. It'll be really fun and really, really good. But I'm the one he knows, so I definitely have to be there and meet him.
Right.
So that'll be that's the reason for my exit whenever I make it.
All right. And thank you, Alfred. Anything
okay.
else?
I'm all set.
Yeah, you're all set. Yeah.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you again.
Thank you.
Great time.
Yeah.
All right. I just want to remind, Judy didn't need to come tonight. I just wanted to remind you folks that the primary election is August 14th, which is the day after the select board meeting. Judy will put out her normal email looking for volunteers. I don't know what people's time is like. I'm usually always available to
do. So it's a Tuesday?
Whatever she needs, yeah, it's Tuesday.
So I probably have to work.
So if you look for Judy's email and you're able to do it, we're trying to keep the number of people here limited because we're gonna have to have stuff set up all around. I was in here on Sunday reviewing the warrants and all that, and Donna and Judy and Barbara were in here testing the tabulator. So I just want you guys to know that, you know, there's a lot of work in the background that goes into getting ready for these elections, mm-hmm. and a lot of time and effort. Donna volunteered her time.
Actually, I charged the town for this time.
Did you? Okay, good. Because I know you've met with Sandra several times on different things. So just, you know, just keep that in the back of your mind that, you know, it is a lot. I went to, Judy and Barbara went to two different trainings. I went to one that was at the Montpelier City Hall. Maybe it was last week. I can't remember. It was Will Senning from Secretary of State's office and his crew and going over the primary election stuff and all that. So I did attend that as well. And, you know, that was an evening thing, so that was their time as well. So just when we're remembering to say, you know, thank you. A lot goes into this behind the scenes before we even get to Election Day.
And I told Judy and Barbara that I would be here for after.
Okay, good.
Help with the
counting and all that.
The whole tabulator thing.
Right.
It was a checklist, so we pulled that out. And
oh, you found the checklist.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Mm-hmm. So, anyways... That's just a heads up to be looking for that, and if you can volunteer some time to help, that would be greatly appreciated. Town hall renovation. Let's see if John Brightman is still talking.
Hey, John.
Is he keeping Sandra from making dinner?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Oh, while I'm waiting for John, I'll send these around for signing. There's a whole bunch of places to sign now, and now that we have all this NEMRIC stuff, there's the road commissioner orders that every page needs to be signed. There is this here that needs to be signed.
I hope you didn't approve that motor.
You snoozed, you lose.
Right. This is the, which one is this? This is cemetery stuff, I guess, that we need to sign. And I'm going to ask Sandra about these. Remind me when we
do staff meeting on Wednesday about these. And then there's the payroll stuff to be signed. Denise hasn't seen this check yet. Okay. This is another stuff to be signed. Just, there's a whole bunch more places now to sign than there ever was before. So I'm gonna start this around, start with Rose. So we're just getting ready to do the town hall update, John. Where do you guys wanna start?
Are you all aware of the gift we received?
No.
Heard a rumor.
So we received a gift for the town hall for $200,000.
Wow.
That's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
That is pretty amazing.
So the donor's anonymous right now, but will not be forever. And we actually have the check. And
it was me.
So we just deposited the check. So it means we can do some things that we didn't, that we thought we were going to move off to phase three. We can paint the outside of the building and sand the floors.
And we have to replace the floors.
Yeah. I mean, there's tons of details. We don't have to go into all the details of that building over there. But
I wasn't sure whether it was ready for public.
Yeah, it's a... and so we're going to be doing less fundraising. I talked to Christine and Shauna, the fundraisers we were working with. Apparently, Historic Preservation wants to continue with them in some fashion. I don't know how. We're going to continue to pursue foundations. And maybe in the end have some kind of a fund that we can invest that helps maintain the building. We'll see where we are at the end of the project. Isn't that great?
That's
awesome.
Really. I was speechless, believe it or not.
It's amazing.
You were speechless.
I was.
Yeah, that is truly amazing.
It's like, yeah.
Wow.
And I'm not speechless very often.
Yeah.
Wow. Don't you laugh.
So really some of the real stuff started today. Deconstruction Works is the company that is deconstructing the inside. And
they're wrecking the place inside.
Yeah, I know.
Actually, it looks pretty.
Yeah, I was there.
Really open and big. Yeah.
Yeah. The wall with the line from the 84 flood, that's they saved that wall aside.
They did.
Oh, that is so cool. I'm glad they saved that.
Yeah. We can't put it back.
No, but
we're raising the building 2 feet. So
we had to put the line lower.
God, I got
You could mark it lower.
Yeah. Well, John said he saw evidence of other floods when they started tearing through the park.
It's interesting. There's part of the old stairways exposed. It will be getting covered up again, so it'll be impossible to view. But right now, you go in there and you see the high water from various floods.
That's really cool. Mm-hmm.
It's very interesting.
So you're taking pictures. Yeah.
Yeah, we're documenting it because I think at some point it'd be nice to hang up some pictures in the town hall when it's done. And just so you know, that addition that's being torn off is not part of the historic structure.
Right.
That was actually built in 1984, so it is not part of the historic piece of that building. Mm-hmm. So I just want to make sure you guys are all aware of that in case you hear
rumors otherwise.
So you're going to have the excavator crew to put that one down, you said?
Yeah, I'll put it down.
It's easier.
Yeah.
It's quicker.
I want to watch that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what else, Donna?
Let's see.
We want to sign the lift contract.
Well, let me just go through a quick list first.
Okay.
So, Geddes, the building lift remover, is coming August 1st. They say it'll only take 2 days. Do you want to say anything about the foundation?
August 1st, you said?
August 1st. That's like a week from Wednesday, isn't it?
It's soon.
You haven't hired a concrete guy yet for the foundation?
You know, Scott's working on an RFP. We're going to send it to Singleton, Gendron.
And I think
it'll be Sayers and another.
Yeah, I think Sayers.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've got it on my notes.
So who did the concrete? I know I talked to John a while ago, concrete up at the Chamberlain place on Apple Hill where they did the faux granite.
Well, that was Brooke House.
That was Brooke.
Yeah.
Is he being solicited? He's such a wonderful job.
He doesn't do this kind of concrete.
He's doing the chimney.
Well, if you could have
chimney.
Him do the finish work on there. So
it's only 8 inches. The foundation wall showing.
Showing here?
Yeah. John, he's doing the chimney.
Yeah, Brooke House
is doing
the chimney.
Yeah. He's already been working on it.
So we're having the internet and the phone moved to the telephone pole.
Thank you so much. I got completely bogged down.
No, that was just ridiculous. That took like 4 phone calls.
Yeah.
Power maybe moved onto a new pedestal, maybe tomorrow.
Yeah.
And the WEC's coming to do that, right?
Yeah.
And John, we were trying to get Andy Felice to build the pedestal. Timing didn't work out, so John, yet again. Something you shouldn't have had to do, but still, it's time consuming.
We're using Dan Cowan as the electrician for this piece of it. That's about that. And John has totally specced out the electrical schedule and what lights go where, and we reviewed that with Cliff and Denise at the building committee meeting. And now he's working with Alan Gould. For emergency. And he's a, is he a mechanical engineer?
No, I think he's electrical, but he's going to do the design. Tell us what the fire alarm consists of, where the pull stations go, where the exit lights should be, exit signs should be, et cetera, et cetera.
And we're looking at a generator like we have here that will come on automatically, not one you got to go over and crank it and fill it with gas and all that.
John met with J.O. Reardon, so we finally have
Yeah, that was good.
Jim O'Reardon?
Jim O'Reardon, yeah, we've got a real good handle on the mechanical part of this.
Okay. And didn't you meet with Labor and Industry today?
And I didn't.
And he came home happy.
And I came home happy.
Okay.
Really?
The reason is?
You can explain it.
If I was just going by the book, literally, either the International Building Code or NFPA, it would be a completely different design, but because it's an historic building, they cut a lot of slack, which is great unless you're trying to design and you have no idea what's slack and what's not.
I see.
So there was a component to an accessible egress route, which might have added another 3 feet in length to the rear addition. Fortunately, it's not required because it's an old building, so we're good. Everything was good.
Good. Yeah.
And that being said, there's still good access and egress, and handicap access will be still.
Oh yeah. Great. Yeah. No, they wouldn't have let us slide if they thought we were doing anything that would put a user at risk.
Good.
And I'm trying to encourage John to submit an invoice. This man has worked nonstop, day and night, late nights, weekends, and he deserves to get paid a portion of what he's doing.
That's going to be on Donna to get him to do that.
Right.
Because
I'm going to live in my soda and
get him gone. One thing Jim O'Reardon did say is he wanted us to have clear water come.
Oh, yeah.
Clear water filtration,
good idea.
Which, does the system here. So.
Yeah, this is the same water. So clear water can just come and deal with this place.
So they're coming on the 30th, which is, I guess, is that next Tuesday?
July 30th?
Yeah, so they'll meet John over there.
It's a Monday.
Yeah. So I have, do you want to talk about the lift at all? I have the contract here.
There's nothing new here. We always knew the amount was in 29. $7,000 or something like that. Mm-hmm. You have to pick a color.
But this lift, though, the money to pay for the lift, though, is coming out of that grant that we hope to get, right?
That's a major accessibility expense, and if we want to be reimbursed by the grant, we can't actually spend that money until after September.
Right. And
when I talked to Bob Weber tonight, he's the guy at Accessibility Solutions.
Yeah.
And you know, you can sign that, but then we have to choose the color. John has to
verify
the dimensions. And he's worked with other historic buildings that are funded by cultural facilities grant.
Mm-hmm.
So I will know on Wednesday. So I said, can I just call you on Wednesday and let you know if we got the grant or not? Because if we didn't get the grant, we could just lose the money.
This Wednesday?
August 1st.
Okay.
So if we don't get the grant, then you know we'll have to pay the total price.
Right.
He's looking for a deposit, you know, to go with the contract. And I said, well, you take less. If we do get the grant, can we just give you a little bit of money?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, then we just decide, we'll just wait and see if we get the grant.
Well, this, it says on this that he wants 87, 87.5.
Right, yeah. But he'll, I think he'll take it.
Front. Okay. So and I'm just this is got signed for deconstruction, just so you know, for the 2400.
Is there a check there for them, or?
There's just the stub. So I would imagine you could probably get it tomorrow.
Oh, okay. From Sandra. Scott's supposed to be working on that.
Okay.
But she was able to issue a check, I guess.
Yeah, okay. We just signed off on the check.
Yeah. Okay, great.
So you're looking for the board to approve us signing the accessibility systems paperwork for the lift, which we hope to cover it with the grant. The grant was $35,000?
The grant's $30,000. It's for the lift and for, what was the other thing?
Anything.
It has to do with the bathrooms, right?
Oh, the bathrooms, yeah.
That starts with the underslab plumbing.
And that's the Vermont Art that's the Vermont Council on Arts grant.
Right.
Yeah.
Really? For a lift?
Yeah. I know. Yeah. And it has to meet all kinds of code requirements from labor and industry, and that's another reason to get a generator that is going to come on automatically if there's something going on and you don't want somebody stuck in the elevator.
That's right. That's right. And this guy is the guy. He's probably the only guy, right?
Yeah, he is. Well, no, there's some other people.
Well, Lisa Ryan, who works with Preservation Trust of Vermont, she said if you can find any other vendor out there, please let me know, because for the grant, we were supposed to present three different bids, but there just aren't three different people out there.
Huh.
But the Arts Council understands that.
Okay. So would the select board like to authorize me to sign this contract with accessibility systems?
Yeah, basically what he said was send him the contract. He can't order it until John checks the dimensions and we choose a color anyway. Color. So we'll just wait till August 1st and see if we get the grant.
So it comes with its own wall or something or surrounding
it? It's a real cab. It's a real, like a micro elevator.
Really? Yeah. Doors?
The whole thing.
It's not.
In fact, this guy's got doors on two sides.
Really?
So the third stop directs it out a side door on the same level as the stage. And then you go right from there to the stage.
Oh.
The Arts Council loved that.
Yeah, this is cool.
Yeah.
This is standard stock type equipment?
Yeah.
It is actually.
Not custom.
Yeah, it is.
So I make a motion to approve Denise signing that contract with them for the lift.
Okay. For a second.
I'll second.
And his quote was part of the grant, too.
Yeah. Any further
discussion? I'd just like to ask a question. What state was the elevator invented in?
I don't know. Alexa's not here to answer.
What's that?
What state
was the elevator
invented in?
You know Alexa, right?
Oh. Otis invented in Illinois?
Wisconsin.
No, Vermont. Windsor, Vermont.
Really?
Yeah.
Just like the soapstone stove.
For all the high-rises.
Well, yeah, I don't know about that, but
Donna, do you want this or do you want me to keep this?
He wants two copies.
Can you make like five copies? Because when I start file for this, I'll need a copy.
He wants me to send him two signed copies.
Okay.
So.
All right. Now the last thing about the town hall.
You vote for it.
Oh yeah, do you want to vote for it? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All right. I'm going to bring up the other issue unless you have something more. So we had our DRB hearing on last Thursday to talk about the permit applications that we filed on behalf of the town, which you know about. And there was quite a lot of discussion, and we decided that really this is a two-phase kind of thing. There's and this is why I brought up the fact that the Glenwood demolition on the back is not a historic piece of the building.
Mm-hmm.
It's really just about the raising and the moving of the current building. That's the first piece. The second piece, and we'll have to file a new application for this, would be the change of use when we get ready for that. And if you go back really in the historical documents, the uses technically really aren't changing all that much.
Mm-hmm.
We've been very clear that the main use of that building is municipal. We've been very clear about that. The building committee's been very clear about that. And if you look back, the Ladies' Home Mission, they used to do dinners, sewing bees, quilting bees, poetry reading, you know, shindigs, whatever.
Yeah.
That was really the historical use of that building.
Yeah.
But
in between town meetings and other town uses.
Right, right. The upstairs piece, basically.
Mm-hmm.
The downstairs is really reserved for municipal space other than the...
That's your call.
Thank you. Other than the kitchen piece of it. So anyway, so we kind of had this discussion with the DRB the other night, and I have a letter here that I'd like to sign on behalf of the select board to officially ask the DRB to break this into two separate pieces. You got the piece that we have right now, which is the raising and the moving, and then later on, because we don't really have a good time frame for when we might start using the building for different things other than, I don't know what else, but... So I'd like permission to sign this. The letter's right up there on the board.
And who would appear on our behalf to present this to the record? Okay. So we're authorizing you to present this and speak to this as well.
Right. And there's a continued hearing of the one from last Thursday night to tomorrow night that I'll plan to attend.
Okay.
But I'd like to get this letter to them as soon as possible, even before the meeting. I would like to scan it and send it. So if this is acceptable...
That's good.
So it's pretty just straightforward, straight to the point.
So moved.
Second.
All right. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Okay. So that's done. Anything else you want to say about the DRB hearing, John or Donna?
No.
It was quite uneventful, is my understanding. So.
Well,
it's interesting. Nothing.
You usually expect flack from the people attending, you know? This is all coming from the DRB.
It was kind of the other way around.
It was very disappointing because we've had so much cooperation from labor and industry.
Everybody
has to stand right to the camera. Division of Historic Preservation.
The select board.
The select board. The town. The town voted $200,000.
Right.
And there were too many alternates and too many. There are too many people that didn't have a good grasp of the regs.
Yes,
well, and also
right.
we have a legal opinion. And I knew this, and I've said this before, the DRB has no authority to appoint alternate members on its own. They have to be appointed by the select board, period.
Right. So going forward, they'll probably behave a little differently because they'll be constituted differently than they were at the last meeting.
They really don't have much on their plate.
No.
Apparently not.
Yeah, looking at the building or moving it, the DAB is fine with any.
Right. And that's really what the focus is right now. So we got to remember, and in fairness, I don't think any of us even thought about, we have to file an application.
Yeah.
You know, we've been so busy doing everything else that it's like, duh. And then we tried to make it so that it was everything, and then we got stuck.
Right.
So it was like, you know, we tried.
So you're going to bifurcate it.
Right. And I think that makes the most sense. It makes it cleaner all the way around. And then we can do the change of use thing and do a really good job. I got to say, John did a fabulous presentation. I mean, he answered every single question and then some that they asked that weren't even within their purview. So I think, you know, there was a real good faith effort made to give them a thorough picture of everything.
Thank you, John.
Thank you, John and Donna.
Right. Yes, ma'am.
So, if I might ask a question, it's related to the historic district and an historic building, but not the town hall. And Don is here, so I thought you might have a little bit of intel. How's the progress going on the rebuild of the Old West Church steeple? Did they put a roof? Did I see any roof on the structure?
They found the remnants of the old roof framing system. It had the bell curve, very pretty shape.
Wow.
And back the entire spire hasn't been put on yet. So right now it just has a piece of wood that's 8 feet long. But right, it looks like a bell. It looks like the Jolly Green Giant can come to pick it up and bring it. It's so cute.
Great. Sharon, I know you're gonna have to leave. Did you sign the orders?
I haven't yet. But you guys have,
we have enough.
You have enough people without them. Yeah, without me.
Okay.
Yeah, John's on the building committee with that.
Okay.
And I'm the treasurer, so.
Of course you guys are.
And some people don't think we're too powerful.
Yeah, you're very powerful.
I don't see them volunteering to do anything.
I was gonna say, usually the people.
That's a real high-level job there.
Yeah, I know.
Well, usually the people that complain and stuff the most, it's like, you know my motto, if you complain, you shall serve.
Then they vanish.
Right, and then they vanish into thin air.
I am interested in the next item. I'm disappointed we didn't get to it. Do you expect to make a decision tonight?
The special events ordinance.
Yeah, I would like to. Would you like to weigh in quickly before you leave?
Sure.
Are we done?
Yeah, sorry.
Done with town hall stuff?
Good night and thank you.
See you tomorrow.
Thanks, John.
See you tomorrow night.
See you tomorrow.
Awesome job.
I'll just close everything out.
I think we're really just at this point talking about what do we think about even thinking about this.
So you're not going to make it. So
Well, no, there will be a decision.
There'll be a decision, but we're not going to.
That's possible. Not, sure.
Right.
Okay. I think.
Yes, I would like to.
So I made a. So I'll just step back and give you my sentiment. It was an interesting juxtaposition to see this coming up at the same time that we've been talking about consolidation of schools and what it means to be a community.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that I could understand why Berlin mm-hmm. would want a...
They're way bigger than us.
Way bigger and way a different, bigger. Very different kind of community with all of the industry and businesses that they have.
We don't have any of that.
We don't have any of that. But we do have, when I sat down and thought about it, we have a lot of activity in our town that would be affected by a permit. And I made a list. You guys probably just think that. Thought about it the same way I did, but I think that this is not that an ordinance like this is not how we solve the problems that so far have come up, and mm-hmm. I would rather see us solve them as a community in the exact spirit that we talked about in the context of the school. We're a small community. We know each other. In Berlin, Barry, you don't maybe know your neighbors. You do call the authorities, and there's some ordinance to kind of back you up. But here, I feel like the way that we solve the problems, at least that so far have presented themselves, are just by talking to our neighbors.
Well, and that's exactly what happened tonight at the bridge.
Exactly. So I would really want us to see, I would want to see us continue to talk about our community in that way, mm-hmm. as a community where we know our neighbors and we talk to our neighbors, and we don't, we're a small town, we don't need, and really, if we wanted to follow it through, we'd probably, managing this kind of an apparatus is would get out of control pretty quickly. It's not who we are.
That's no, and also the piece that I've thought about too, in addition to that,
that's just catching up on.
Yeah, I forgot to get you guys to sign that last meeting. This is for the Adamant Cooperative Way
that we are.
But there's also the piece of who's going to enforce that.
And once you have it, people will expect it to be enforced, and there will be kids running by.
Bicycles because or whatever.
And people, it'll look like, you know,
So anyways, thank you, and go pick up your kid.
Yeah.
That'll be fun.
Have a wonderful vacation with him or time together.
Oh, you guys will see him. I mean, he's going to be here for a month.
Oh, good.
And taking in, you know, what it means to be a, you know, he's American. Well, he's half American, but he hasn't been here. Really. Well, he's visited, but, you know, this will be his first.
Kind of like the fresh air Japan trip.
Yeah. From Tokyo to Calais.
Oh, that's pretty
so,
cool.
So, like, yeah, I'll bring him to on the 12th of the day or whatever it is. And,
yeah.
We have less radioisotopes in our atmosphere at the moment, too, so.
Yeah, I mean, it really is fresh air, right?
Yeah.
It really is.
Okay, so with that.
Thank you for letting me share my thoughts.
All right, so. Pat Finney I sent him an email with the agenda, told him it was going to be on, invited him to come.
Pat Finney here?
I haven't seen him. Mm-hmm. And he's the one that was originally the one that put out the request that we have a special events ordinance because there are periodically bicycle tours, you know, runs, and people have set up water stations near his driveway. He felt like people were looking in his windows, things like that. So I thought we should talk about it and see where we are as a town on this issue. And he's not here to weigh in. So I'd like to go around the table. Rose, we'll start with you.
Sure. I agree with what Sharon said, and I did have one call from another member of our town and expressed the same sentiment that Sharon expressed. And what I had been feeling is that, you know, the culture in town, our community in town, the size of our town, there's so many different reasons that, you know, I really don't feel that we need to have a special permit or an ordinance of this effect. And I agree, if something comes up, we deal with it and we touch our community and move forward from there. But I don't think we need to add another level of government and who's going to enforce it and so on and so forth. So, and I think that's one of the nice things about Calais is that, you know, Adamant has the Black Fly Festival and Maple Corner has their little things, and there's different little things that go on in addition to all the happenings at the school. Mm-hmm. And we want to promote that because that's what makes Calais special. So I agree that I think that we gave it some discussion and deliberation, but it's not a right fit for our town at this point.
Cliff? Yeah, I would certainly second everything that's been expressed. We're a small town. We can always communicate. That's the key to success. It's conceivable that something could come up, some event larger in scale than what we're used to, and I think we would deal with it then. With that in mind, the only thing we might want to consider, and I'm not saying we should, but just to throw it out there, if we wanted to have something on record saying that we have a policy in place that if there's going to be an event that's larger than X number of people.
Well, I wonder, is there some kind of labor and industry regulation that if an event is so many people, you have to have porta potties and you have to hire sheriffs? Isn't there some kind of?
I don't know.
We should make a note. If you can make a note in the minutes, Katie, I'll check it out, because there might already be something, you know, statewide.
Public safety.
Public safety that. If there's an event of a certain number of people, I know sometimes concerts.
I think usually where there's food dispensed, you need to have hand wash facilities and bathroom facilities.
I can check that piece out just to see if we're covered in that respect for really large events. But I'm sorry, were you done?
Nope, that's exactly what I wanted to bring up.
Okay, John?
So I know that I read Mr. Finney's, Patrick Finney, my neighbor. Mm-hmm. Full disclosure. He's my next closest neighbor to the south of me. I consider him a friend. And I saw his concerns, and there was some email conversation that didn't make it into the formal record here. I'm willing to provide it. Anybody wants to see it, it's not much. But the clerk was included on that. I think Denise was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
very least, I don't know.
I think he initially contacted the clerk, didn't he?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Yeah. I don't know that it really matters.
So, you know, he was concerned about a water stop related to a race that was headed out of Adamant. It's an annual event. It's a 22-mile race or something. It's like a pre-marathon kind of warm-up race to, the Queen City Marathon in Burlington, generally. And the water station was there. I don't know why they put it where it was. It was an issue for him. And I have offered to the race organizers, they could again set the water station up in front of our property. It's just 7/10 of a mile off the road. And we actually have a hydrant there that they could use for water refilling. So that might make it easier on them. So that's been dealt with. Mr. Finney was concerned about people being able to view inside his home. In the daytime, there's this kind of, what do you call it, angle of refraction or something. When you have light on the outside of a window in the daytime, you cannot see. It's nearly impossible. Maybe you can see a shadow. Add screens to that, it makes it all more difficult. I stopped in front of his house. I walked around on the road, and could not see anything in the daytime. At night, the light's on, probably, but that's all of our houses. My house is right up tight to the road. Lockbush and his is. So that's kind of my view on that, and I don't think anyone's entitled to privacy with their windows open, particularly if you build a house within eyeshot of the road. I bought a house knowing that where the house was, and he built a house knowing where he's putting the house. So that's kind of my sentiment in that. But he did raise this specter of liability for the town. I know that Denise consulted with our attorney, and that's kind of attorney-client. But regarding liability, I looked at the clerk Judy provided us as a possible template, a special event ordinance that was developed for the town and is in play in the town of Berlin.
Yeah.
Sharon referenced it.
I looked at that.
You know, right now we're not involved in these races, bike race, running race, you name it, you know, fundraiser. We're not involved.
Right.
And we set an ordinance in place, and the basis of that ordinance is to reduce risk to the participating public or traveling public where they interact with that. And we establish a set of rules, advisements, standards that are there to protect the public. And what if there is a situation that arises, someone gets injured, someone gets seriously injured or worse, killed, and then that the loved ones of that injured person say, well, the town had 10 requirements, but they forgot the 11th, and that 11th would have saved my son or daughter or husband or wife from this, you know, running headlong into a car or something. I don't know. So I see that putting standards like that into place actually creates a liability for the town. And then with that concern, I would not take this lightly if we were going to put an ordinance in place. I would see we would be, you know, creating risk and liability for the town unless we hired an expert, and then that gets into money. So I think I could talk more about that, but I won't. And I believe that the smartest thing, the safest thing for the town from a liability standpoint is to not get involved, because I don't see any risk. I think the race organizers are very well organized. They have people on the run. There are some impromptu small bike gatherings, but they're like five people. They're not formal bike races that I've seen.
And there's little parades in Maple Corner.
Right.
And
Black Fly Parade.
All
these things have not really been an issue. And
it's just one more layer of government.
Yeah. And it's another thing for our people in this busy office to do.
Somebody to manage.
And there's a fee. There's a long list of grievances I have with even the idea, the prospect of this. And, you know, lastly, Berlin ordinance, like Denise and Sharon said, Berlin's got how many traffic lights and dangerous. I mean, they'd be crazy not to have an ordinance.
Right.
And I know if they had a safety expert review their ordinance. Wayne Lamberton, if they haven't, you might want to look at that.
Right.
He's on the select board. So, you know, I guess in some, I would oppose any effort by the select board to try to put an ordinance in place to regulate this. And that's me.
And I would just second and echo all the comments that have already been made. The enforcement piece, I think it does, in a sense, make us create liability that we don't currently have. And we are a small community. We talk to each other. Look at, you know, people call us at home, they send us emails. It's not like we're out of touch or don't communicate.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Berlin is huge.
Yeah.
And they've got a lot of paved roads. And, I mean, that is a whole different community than what we are.
Mm-hmm.
So do you think that we need to make a motion that we're not going to?
I think the minutes can just reflect our sentiment.
That we're choosing not to take action. And we actually haven't developed an ordinance anyway. It's a conversation.
Right.
But at this point in time, we don't.
I think it's unanimous agreement not to pursue a special events ordinance.
Right.
Reflected in the minutes.
There's been no compelling reason, rationale for this.
I mean, really, I've gotten maybe two phone calls about events that have taken place over how many years?
Right.
You know? I mean, there's one that goes by my house because it comes from Woodbury, and you know, that whole route there. So it's like, you know, the only thing is, you know, I'm making sure my dogs are behind the fence so they don't chase anybody.
Yeah.
But that's okay. So I think we're done with that, right?
Yeah.
All right. I am going to send this around. This is the grand list that we have to sign off on.
Oh, okay.
All right, next up. So a concerned citizen raised the issue of wanting to be able to look at the documents Select Board had in Google Docs. And that's a legitimate request, that those documents be available to the public. So I wanted to talk to you guys about this. Because what I'd like to suggest is that Cliff and I work with Scott, who was the original person that set up the website and did all that stuff, and Katie, who's the one who's been doing documents, to see if there's a way that we can set up a Google folder that anybody in town or anybody in the world wants to access to see what documents we're going to be talking about at the meeting.
I have an answer.
What?
Yes.
We can do that.
We can do it. Okay.
So rather than take everybody's time here, I'm suggesting that Scott and Cliff and I and Katie chat and get back to the board with the suggestion and then see if everybody's in agreement to approve how we might do that. And I thought maybe we could meet after town hall meeting on Wednesday to talk about it. Is everybody...
Except Katie's not here.
No, but we can clue her in or put her on the phone or something.
Okay. Yep.
But because she's doing a lot of the downloading of documents, I think she should be part of the discussion.
Yeah, it would involve another layer of management, but I think there's a pretty simple way to do it, much like what you do with the Select Board folders. Mm-hmm. It would just be a separate folder that you would make those documents available in that's open to public. There's a couple of ways we can open it to the public. And so we can talk about that on Wednesday. And
my concern of not wanting
it. It can be a constant link like you do in the minutes. You have the link to the town website. It would just be the same link.
Right. And the reason that we're thinking about doing it as a separate item is because sometimes there's personnel documents or stuff in the folders that we're looking at. And we don't want to make that accessible to the whole world. Mm-hmm. Because personnel and legal matters are confidential.
Yep.
Okay, are you guys okay with that if we get something started? All right. So there was a EMFD quarterly budget update meeting last week on the 19th, which I wouldn't have been able to go to anyways, but it completely fell off my radar. I thought it was in August for some reason. The fire department did not, like, remind us, which I guess they don't have to hold our hand and remind us. Bruce... Johnson from East Montpelier went and he sent around a copy of the documents that were discussed. It would be really helpful for sure to know, and I can put them on our calendar, when those meetings are. And I just think it was unfortunate that they didn't think to remind us. And I know Rose has some thoughts on that. And I think that maybe they need to hear back from the board, from somebody they might listen to.
Turning it to.
Okay, it goes in that.
I'm spacing out.
That's okay.
Listening to you and not watching what I'm doing.
I'm glad you're listening to me, Richard.
two levels of listening, as you know.
Yes. And I'm thinking that Rose might be the appropriate person to send draft something for the board to sign off on, requesting one that we know the exact dates, because like I said, I thought it was in August. And
would we be up for a redo? Like
we might
we
be.
Would like for them to come here and tell us what we missed?
Yeah, we might be.
Seems that they shouldn't have had the meeting. They kind of didn't have a full meeting.
Well, they did. There wasn't. And I
there was
say,
no one from the East Montpelier board.
No, and
there
there's
no
sometimes,
one from the Calis board.
And sometimes there's not a good groups. Showing from the East Montpelier board.
Right.
But there is always a quorum from the Calis select board. Always.
Right.
So for none of us to show up, that should be quite telling.
I think it was a screw up. It's summer. Everyone's busy. It's a volunteer fire department.
We're volunteers.
And I don't see, I'm sure they would entertain a request.
Oh, yeah.
To redo it.
So yeah. I would suggest that Rose draft something up.
Yep. Just for the record, I was the administrative assistant for EMFD for 6 years. And so I sent out notices to the select boards.
You used to remind us.
What?
You used to remind us.
Yeah, I said that was...
Jenna, what's her name? Jenna that was there used to...
Judy Woodbeck is the administrative assistant now.
Yeah.
So she should have been instructed by the board of directors and the president of the fire department, who happens to be Toby Talbot.
To remind the boards.
To remind the boards that the quarterly joint meeting is coming up. And so I think, in my view, it was a clear... Maybe it was just an innocent oversight, but... in light of the fact that neither the East Montpelier nor the Calais boards were there, I think it's definitely within our purview to ask for a summarized version of what we missed at that meeting, and they can come here to this meeting.
Okay.
So I gladly work on drafting a letter.
Thank you, Rose.
Gladly.
All right. I don't know how much more you want to do, but I do... want to get through a couple of things. David Ellum, and it's almost 9 o'clock and we're striving for 9, right? A couple of appointment stuff. Karen McNeil has agreed to be the alternate to the TAC, which is what David Ellenbogen serves on. Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Trails Committee, reappoint Gail Graham and Charlotte Hannah Bassage.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Webmasters. I didn't think Scott might not, I thought Scott might not be interested in continuing as webmaster, but I was thinking Katie, Judy, and I asked Scott, and he is still interested, and I think actually him still being available to help out with the web stuff would be really helpful.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd like to appoint all three as webmasters, okay? Is there a second?
Question, do we want to have a... they just all share responsibility and work it out amongst themselves, or do you say somebody's a primary?
I think Judy is like the primary.
I would check with her before I did anything.
Right.
Okay. We don't need to formalize that, but.
Do you think, well, maybe we should.
I don't know. I'm not familiar with how that usually works.
I know it's handy sometimes, like Katie might not be around or Judy's not around, and Scott will post something on for me.
That's
so.
Great. As long as what we have works, then.
And I think if there's an issue, then maybe we fix it.
Well, if you send it, like say I had something to post on the website, you just send one email, but you put it to three people and you say, please post the minutes.
Right.
And somebody posts
it. Right. And that's like a Katie thing.
Yeah.
To do that.
Yeah.
We can keep track amongst each other a little bit who's doing what.
And it's interesting because today is a perfect example why Scott makes sense for him to still be a webmaster, is there was some kind of a snafu in your office. Judy did something, and with signing into the website stuff, and she forgot her password or something. And then Scott got an email, and it looked like it was a spam or a hacker thing. So because he was instrumental in setting everything up, he contacted the web company, whatever they're called.
.gov.
Yeah, and worked it out, and it really wasn't spam.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a good reason for, I think it's keeping Scott on. It's another double check. So, all right. All of that is done.
Do you want to second that?
Oh, yeah. Somebody?
I seconded.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Okay, any opposed? Hearing none. All right, quickly. Update. Nelson Pond boat fire. Did you guys hear about that? A boat on Nelson Pond on the Calais end near the place where the Nelson Pond runs through into number 10.
Oh.
Saturday, I guess it was Saturday morning, I heard all these fire engines, all this and that stuff going on. And then I started getting calls. A boat caught on fire and like burnt, disintegrated into Nelson Pond.
Oh.
So Woodbury Fire Department responded. Wilson called me and said, what do I do? So I think you need to contact the state hazmat, because that's gasoline, fiberglass into the water, A&R has a 1-800 after hours number, and they con, so he called, Woodbury Fire Department called, and I called to make sure that it was on record that we had reported this hazmat thing. So that's done. Elizabeth Shed Horses, she has put something on Front Porch Forum looking for a GoFundMe thing to raise money to buy a draft horse. She actually has gotten some responses. I checked the site, and she's gotten like $500, and she's looking for $7,500. I continue to get calls. Wilson continues to get calls. Judy continues to get calls. And we've checked it out every which way we can. There's just no way for the town to do a whole lot of anything. The latest event was an Alan and Susan Spaulding, who live on Collar Hill, where she built a fence on their property so her horses could graze. He and his sons were going last weekend to take the fence down. And as Jim has said multiple times, really the course of action is for the neighbors to get together and do something. There really is nothing for the town to do.
Right.
Only recommendation he had, and I'm willing to work on this letter, is for the letter for the select board to send a letter saying that you cannot park your wagon in the road, in the town right of way, and you can't graze your horses.
The travel portion, the you can park it in the right of way. The
travel portion.
It's a big difference.
Because this other gentleman that I talked to also raised the fact that she lets her horses graze in the road at night or at dusk, and somebody's going to hit one of those horses and something awful is going to happen. So I would like to see if you want me to draft a letter, which I can bring back for the board to approve.
I'd like to review that letter before presenting.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm going to bring it back to
the
board.
And I wanted to ask you to go in executive session in this regard a little bit.
Oh, okay. All right, so my last thing is the resolution's been distributed far and wide. We got a lot of good response from various different people about the resolution. And I was wondering, should we be distributing this to some of the media? Will Walters asked me for it, so I sent it to him.
What's that?
The resolution, F46.
That we sent to the governor.
Whether or not we should be trying to do some kind of an op-ed piece for the Times Argus. It was suggested that we send it to 7 Days, DPR, and I can do this. I just want to get your thoughts on where else we might send it.
Well, I think, when is the Board of Education meeting?
8/15, August 15th.
That's the one at the State House that we're asked to attend.
Good.
We can make I can make extra copies here.
I would like to see the whole select board attend that if we can.
Denise, what day of the week is
whether
it?
Or not we speak, we should just be present.
15th is a Wednesday.
A Wednesday?
Yeah. I don't know what time it's at. Do you? I don't think it's been determined. But anyways, beyond that, and I do think that I was planning to attend anyways, but for the resolution, VPR, 7 Days, somebody said the Brattleboro Reformer. I don't know.
What about the bridge?
Bridge. That's the one in East Montpelier, right?
Montpelier.
Okay. Yeah, I guess the advantage of that is it does hopefully raise awareness and maybe puts more voices at that meeting.
Yeah. You mean to distribute it to the media?
Mm-hmm.
And then John had suggested maybe a version of the resolution to be sent to the Times Argus as an op-ed piece. I was also thinking about sending the resolution to King of Buhlenberg and Warner Shed and asking them if they might be interested in writing an op-ed piece. So I think Warner was at some of the meetings, right? I can double check with some of the school board members.
Mm-hmm.
But they're very articulate. You know, it might be nice for somebody else to be having a voice in all this.
Mm-hmm.
Is that an evening meeting?
I think, no, it's during the day. I don't know what time. You?
I don't know, I'm asking.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know really anything.
I don't know that they. I don't know even if they know yet. The school board. We can see if we can get a date. I can ask.
That meeting at U32 that we attended. That's when they said.
Right, the State House meeting.
No, when we, the meeting that we're at U32, that meeting, they said, it, you know, the appeal or whatever will be heard on August 15th.
But it's during the day, I think.
Yeah.
But we don't know what time, and I can follow up with the school board and see if they know yet and let everybody know.
I don't think I'll be able to be there. I'm having knee surgery on Wednesday, and so I have a week off. Bugs are coming in. I'm getting a week off, so okay. I don't really want to ask for more time off.
Okay. All right. And I'm going to suggest that anything else we have, the minutes I think can wait till next time.
I'd like to request that we go into executive session concerning a potential legal matter, and then actually two legal matters, and one has to do with the grant list thing that we've been encouraged to sign today. Uh-huh. I signed and I read it, what I signed, and it's a good conversation about that. And,
is that a motion, John?
Yes.
I'll second it.
At 9:04.
Yeah.